revisit, which we understand. There are terms which are developed. And the second part is where we take examples of rights, civil, human and democratic, and we do some kind of analysis in the context of this conceptual framework which we are establishing. We go into some very, very critical, crucial concept which R.S. Rao deals with, which establishes the context within which we can then proceed to understand rights within the Indian context. There are three parts he's talking about. That the establishment of the new civil society framework and its codified laws is civil rights. Second, the new property relations of capital labor, which allowed for capital accumulation, production of goods and services, and corresponding expansion of the market, this narrates and correlates with the democratic rights of the people. The third is the release and growth of massive forces of production, knowledge, technology, science, all these translated into the three. This was the human rights dimension which was developed. So he establishes these three correlations, the democratic, the human and the civil, to property relations, productive forces and superstructure. While the new bourgeois democratic society saw the dynamics of its functioning in terms of the relationship between state and civil society, he makes a departure here between the Marxist orientation of understanding rights. As bourgeois democratic rights, it is state and civil society. He introduces that as Marxists, the third dimension of class relations and political economy for the study of societal movement and change is fundamental, crucial and most important. Without this third dimension, you cannot put into perspective any of these three rights. He lays down further interesting conceptual terms and terminology in the framework. He says a right, and this is very, very fundamental. He uses the word right is the freedom or choice of an individual to do or not do something. The choice of an individual, freedom to do or not do something, including the writings and propaganda he develops for it and the collectives, organizations and programs he forms for action. He lays the fundamental ground rule over here. When freedom to exercise these is denied, that is, if the person's choice to do or not do something and to change something is denied, and the person is expected to observe the existing laws, rules, conditions, then all these rules, laws, conditions become an obligation, in fact become a duty. This inversion takes place immediately. If that individual does not have the right to change his conditions, but is asked to comply with the rules and regulations, then it becomes a duty. One of the most easy examples is the right to vote. You have the freedom, the choice to vote or not to vote. Forget whom to vote. You have the choice, freedom to vote or not to vote. But if in case this freedom is withdrawn, then it becomes your duty to vote. Sorry, yes sir, it's a right and duty between us. Accordingly, a right is not exercised if it is not exercised. It is deemed as not performing and therefore a duty, and it can become illegal and a crime. These are dependent on the perspective, he says. He brings another set of new concepts into understanding how to view rights. These are dependent on two perspectives, and we have to see from whose point of view. And he says, the state civil society paradigm understanding is an idealist perspective. The state, civil society and political economy is a materialist perspective. So he introduces the idealist and the materialist perspective to understand how you wish to view and how you wish to contextualize any particular interpretation of a law, a rule, a right and a duty. So he says, and he juxtaposes beautifully, idealist perspective locates the individual at the center. The collective exists, the society exists, the rules, the laws, everything exists to satisfy the individual's selfish needs and motives. Once satisfied, the individual can choose to leave the collective. Now it depends on which strata you are. If you are part of the bourgeoisie, you have all rights to exercise and leverage that system as you wish to. Vijayamalaya did, he got caught in certain ways. There are people you can, there is nothing to stop you from accumulating any kind of wealth of any sort and do anything within the rules which are defined based on the property relations of capital labor. That's a given. He flips, he says, in the materialist conception, the individual gets defined in terms of socio-economic relations surrounding that individual. What are the context that individual is in? What are the socio-economic relations that individual is facing? The conditions being mutually dependent between the individual and the circumstances. In materialist perspective, the individual is born, this is a fascinating term, he says, the individual is born in a collective, for example, a family or a religion, or a community or a caste or a region, not having the choice to be in it. He is born without a choice. It is a given. The religion, the family, everything is a given. Now these are important dimensions that we are going to discuss, the rights, democratic rights, human rights of the individual. So from the materialist perspective, the individual is born into a collective, for example, family, community, caste, region, class, and did not get to choose it. He says, in this perspective, the individual can protect his life, right to life, and therefore disobey and violate the rules in order to bring change in the collective, which he is born into without his choice, which will serve towards his right to life and human progress. Completely inverted the choice. The right is being defined now clearly that not being born with a choice, he can challenge anything and everything, the context which he is born into, in a way that it serves his right to life and human progress. He can struggle for land and against bondedness, challenge caste, fight for better wages and working conditions, and even for socialized ownership of the means of production, debate morals, religion and value systems, bypass traditions, customs and social norms, including questions of family construct, gender strictures and women's issues. He can do any question. He has the right. That is his fundamental right. Because he is not born into culture. In the idealist perspective, the individual is obliged to observe the rules and regulations of a collective. You can leverage it as much as you want. Take whatever you want. If you are coming from a privileged section, you can derive whatever. If you are from an unprivileged section, bad luck to you. But the system is there for equal to all. You have to believe in it. All law-abiding citizens must conform to the rules. That's the idealist perspective. But he can also leverage the system to his selfish benefit as much as he wants to, as long as the principal contradiction of capital labor remains untouched. The idealist civil rights perspective attributes autonomy to itself and helps strengthen the system and the state apparatus. Rights go to define the human being. Given rights define you as the human being. You cannot redefine it. In the materialist way, it is the human being that defines rights. So this inversion, the fact that state, civil society, political economy, the context of the human being, not having a choice, basically says that the human being can define the rights. Every individual has the right to oppose rules and regulations that are evolved without his role, right to differ with exchanges, right to materialize its class thinking into practice, right to take these ideas to the people, with the right to organize them. The materialist conception makes it undemocratic. He introduces now the concept of democracy. It's undemocratic to refuse these rights to bring change in the principal property relations that exist. Here comes the departure of a Marxist philosophy on the issues of rights, democratic, human and civil. He says, I will close here and hand it over to you, that the most essential of rights is the fundamental right to life of a human being from which derives all other rights in order to survive and live. a human being utilizes mental and physical labor power. It is through this expression that the individual exists. When this fundamental right is questioned or attacked, the right to life, it is a violation of human rights. Human rights therefore give him the right to struggle against forces that obstruct his fundamental right.